Hey everyone, Luke from A Taste of AZ. On today's episode of the podcast, we've got Arizona food legend, Mark Tarbell. His restaurant has sat many high-profile individuals, and his food is incredible. He's helped a lot of local chefs get their start, so let's jump into the podcast.
Well, we are here. We're at Tarbell's. We're at 32nd Street and Camelback. This place has been here. Well, your place has been here, you said
26 years.
26 years. Yeah. That's incredible, man.
It's incredible. We don't tell anyone. You're not recording this at all.
No, right? I'm not going to release any of this.
No,
this
we like to pretend like we just opened yesterday.
Okay, all right. what do you mean by that?
Well, it's interesting. It's kind of the way I am. You know, I'm really only thinking about today and this moment. I'm only thinking about who we're serving tonight and my philosophy, which was taught to me by great chefs and mentors in this business when I was young, is that's the only thing. You can't live on your laurels. You can't live on awards. You can't live on good articles. It's really what's happening at that table, at that person's table that night.
Yeah.
So for me, I probably have a life conditioning, and I mean this sincerely, I really don't even consider that I've been open that long.
Yeah.
It's like it just is washed through me. I'm just here now. And I guess that helps me feel like this place is still fresh to me.
Yeah. Which, I was going to say, it would have to bring some level of joy, right?
Yeah.
That excitement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love it. I love people. You know, I've shaken over almost 2 million hands over the last 26 years, I calculate.
Make sure you ask him that.
Yeah.
That's so interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. How do you come up with a number like that? Numbers guy?
Well, no, I just kind of did math. You know, I wasn't that good at it. But, you know, like 5 to 6,500 dinners a month, and how many days I work, and how many predictably how many I might have actually.
There's probably shaken. More. It's probably
for sure.
Probably more.
Yeah. I can see you being an underestimate.
A little bit underestimate, but I just want to be like, no one can go, hey, no, you didn't do that.
Yeah. Well, at least that many.
Yeah,
right?
At least that many.
Yeah. Well, Mark Tarbell, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
We have a guest host, my guest host first time as an official guest host.
Yes, thank you for having me.
Yeah.
Am I on your first show?
Yes.
Oh my
gosh.
Well, she has been.
I've sat in on them.
Okay.
But,
and she's been a guest host with Luke, but just not her and I together. So,
oh, cool.
So,
thank you. We're both honored, aren't we, Eric,
yes,
to
I
have
am.
Mark Tarbell?
Yes.
Well, I'm honored.
No, we're honored.
Mark, do you want to introduce who this is?
Oh, yes. This is my favorite person in the world, Christina Barretta. She is she does Write on Ruby blog, and that's where I first was introduced to her. And I just was really, I really admired her approach, her work. She has such a generous heart and spirit when she goes out and reviews people, and also a lot of knowledge and intelligence, takes great pictures. And so that's how we connected, and I started to invite her to events. And she said no a lot. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah.
She said yes. And,
I would change things.
Yes. You know, yeah, we would come in. And then we just got to know each other, and she started writing. This was a year or so ago. You started writing a book on Arizona wine. And I was just so honored that she asked me to write the introduction to it, which I've never done before.
Yeah.
So,
I did not know that.
Yes,
I
never done
it. I figured you'd get, requests 10 a week.
No, I thank you. No, sadly, no. But we both share that passion for Arizona wine and what's happened to it. I've been watching it for, over 30 years now. And it once was, basically coyotes with bandanas on them on a label.
Yeah.
And, cactus wine and stuff like that. And that's how it started. I'm joking a little bit.
Sure.
But,
yeah. That's what people perceived, at least,
yeah,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and then Kent Callahan hits the scene and he gets some national attention. And he's still the godfather of all Arizona wine. But now it's serious. I can honestly say there's a real industry here. It's serious. It's unique. It's special. It's defined. People are using their own methods, their own wines, their own grapes. That are working here, and I'm really proud of to be a part of. I'm only a part of it in that I drink it.
I wouldn't say that, right, Christina?
Well, he's also written it. I mean, his column,
yes.
AZ Central, was, I think you kickstarted Pillsbury Wine with
a review. I wrote for them for about 8 years, a weekly column. And then before that, Arizona Foothills for about 10 years. So, yeah, I love to write about wine. But Christina's book is really the most in-depth, one of the most thorough and in-depth books I've seen on wine. And what you do is you learn a lot about the history of it. It was just very well crafted, and appropriately so for people that didn't understand what was happening here, to really be able to get some context about it, which I really appreciate you doing that.
Oh,
Christina.
Thank you. Yeah. It was tough. I was on my own, so you know, trying. I had some generous photographers contribute photos, and but thank you, and thank you again for doing that.
You
forward.
Bet.
Yeah, I mean, that's a winning combination right there, right? You know, Christina writes it, you do the intro. It's
And then we both drink together.
Yes, we did.
That's the important part.
We did like a little book kickoff here. That was good.
You can't have like a wine book meeting, and then like, oh, I'm sorry, I won't have any
wine. Mark actually hosted the launch party.
I did.
Oh, really? Here
at Tarbell's Wine Store.
Wow. Oh, which is cool. So you have Tarbell's,
and then it's the wine bar right next door, and then the wine store, which is just further west.
Yes. Okay.
It's the corner, basically. 32nd Street and Camelback Corner.
So you could move in here and never leave.
Yeah, really.
You have everything you need.
I'm thinking about it. I don't know the legality of building a patio on your roof to see Camelback Mountain, but...
We're thinking about it.
Yeah. Well, Mark, where did this all start? Like, where are you from?
Well, I was born in New Hampshire.
What is the name of the town?
The town... I was born in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. It's a small town on the coast. And the coastline in New Hampshire, as Christina knows, is only a minute long. You blink and you're through it. It's 13 miles long.
Yeah.
But I grew up in a port town, so it was a sort of commercial fishing and port town.
I hate to interrupt, but I asked you that for a reason. So my sister-in-law and brother-in-law live in Portsmouth.
No way.
And she grew up there. Like, she's a Shanley. I don't know if you knew any of the Shanleys.
Oh,
Joe Shanley.
Yes.
Yeah. So his daughter, Tristan, married my wife's brother.
Oh, that
from
is
Minnesota.
So cool.
Isn't that crazy?
Yes.
Because you posted something about Portsmouth, New Hampshire. I'm like, what? And I reached out to Tristan. I'm like, Tristan, Mark Tarbell, because we've told her about Plate and Pour and all that. And, you know, we're big fans. But just that connection.
Yeah,
so,
that is so cool. It's a much different town. The Shanley family's been there a long time. But
there's like 1,800 of them, I think, in the county.
Yeah, pretty much. It should be called Shanley, not Portsmouth.
Yeah, but exactly.
But they're a great family. But they're, you know, it's so different. You know, it was really a very commercial, you know, tugboats and large freighters of oil and, you know, commercial fishing and was a big part of it. So it was a rugged place. The sea, the waterfront in Portsmouth, New Hampshire was the bad part of town. It was really interesting. And it was all the rundown buildings and things like that. And I remember this guy named Zildjian came in and bought one of the buildings and built this beautiful house on the coast. And we were like, this guy is crazy. Does he know what he's doing? Well, he's the one that makes the symbols, you know, for the Zildjian symbols.
Yeah.
And everyone was just laughing at him. And look who's laughing now. He's
right.
Like, he bought it for like 10 bucks.
Yeah,
he bought the whole thing for like 10 bucks.
And that downtown area is really cool, too, like where the water is, because you kind of have the roads that go down. And I don't know what the name of the place, but there's an old tavern that you got to go down the steps. And it's like a wooden door.
Yeah.
I want to go down. And my wife's like,
Dolphin
I don't know
Striker,
what's
maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So
many, but it's a great place.
And so you grew up there, like through school and all that?
Haven't grown up yet, but that's where I went to high school. I went to, you know, my formative years were there. And, you know, my dad had a boatyard, so I was in the boat sort of business, marine construction and building piers and floats and barges and all that stuff. And so that was my foundation. But during the winter in high school, I started washing dishes.
Okay.
And there were two things that got me into cooking. Well, one, really, I love to eat. And what I learned very early is the cooks get to eat more than I do. So as a dishwasher, you could only eat what was coming off the plates.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, you can delete that if you want. But back in the day, the owners used to sell the job.
No waste.
No waste.
Exactly.
The owners of the restaurants used to sell the job as dishwashers. Like, yeah, you can eat whatever you want off the plates. I'm like, that sounds great, you know, as a teenager. Wow. And so, but the cooks could actually eat food.
Like
you know,
prepare
they could,
it and
yeah, they
eat
could
it.
Cook it.
Yeah.
It. Yeah. So that was a big attraction. Plus, it was just interesting, and I thought it was really fascinating. So I did start cooking. Wanted to do a gap year after high school because I had no other options. And the gap was going to be like 20 years. Yeah. But so through hook or by crook, I met someone whose family owned a hotel in Amsterdam, Holland, and I convinced them into allowing me to take one of the three culinary apprenticeship slots that were normally reserved for Dutch culinary students. So I was popular. I took one of the slots from one of the Dutch kids.
How did you do that? Like, how did you?
Well, you know the owner, you know.
Yeah.
And so that may be even more popular. And so I had three things going for me. I was an American, and I took a slot from a Dutch person. I knew the owner.
Yeah.
Yeah. The chef used to come up to me every day and go, "Are you still here, you goddamn yank?"
And you smile. Probably smile.
He hated me.
Yeah.
Hated me.
Yes, I am.
Yeah. He hated me. But it was fun.
So that was your first, like,
Yes.
Into the...
Yeah, it was a real one-year program. You know, they do it as part of their training in their trade schools over there. So it's you always do an apprenticeship in a restaurant, and it's a very defined program. You go through all the stations. I mean, you start with putting away canned food, then you get to put away the dairy, and then you get to manage, you know, the fresh walk-in, and you learn how to, you know, basically rotate stock and all this stuff. And then eventually you get to cook for the employees of the hotel. That was a big, you know, that was a big promo.
Yeah.
Get to touch food,
yeah.
Actual food. Right. And that guy who did the food was a very interesting character. Didn't like help at all. But and then the kitchen was very international. That was what was so great. And what's great about Holland in general, but there were really only three Dutch people there at night. There was Austrian, German, Moroccan, Tunisian. There was the butcher was Mexican. And then the pantry was run by a Chinese couple. One of the sous chefs was Japanese. So it was really a fascinating place.
A little microcosm.
The chef was Swiss and very mean.
Yeah.
But it was just a great experience. So I went through all the stations and realized I didn't have enough money to get home because I made no money at this. It was like $186 a month after taxes. And so I worked my tail off to get promoted out of the culinary apprenticeship program into being first level cook, which is called commis de cuisine.
Okay.
So, and it was only out of necessity, but I worked my tail off and I was promoted and I made like $260 a month. So
wow.
I was able to earn enough money to fly home.
Yeah. You're earning enough money to get home. Is that basically
pretty
what it
much.
Was?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, was there a spark at that point? Was there something
I was in after 2 months.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know what happened, but it was, I knew then I wanted my own restaurant. I knew I wanted to be a chef. And I applied for schools around Europe. At the time, there was Culinary Institute of America was there, and there was possibly Johnson & Wales, but there wasn't a big culture of food and food education.
Just in the U.S. in general?
In the U.S.
Okay.
Great hotel school, you know, Cornell. But so I just, and all, it was like going to Europe was the thing, and especially going to Paris. So I was focused on getting into the school called Ecole de Cuisine La Varenne, which only took 10 professional, great, you know, professional students a year.
Wow. There was from around the world.
A long waiting list, and but I persisted. I kept writing them and calling them, and one day they basically said, if you never call and write again, and you send us a check, you're in.
Because
someone had just canceled. So persistence. And ignorant, you know, I was just being a kid, you know, I was just like, I was going for it. You know, I didn't care about being, you know, manners or hurting someone's feeling. I just was like, I'm getting in.
Yeah.
So, diligence. Passion.
Yeah.
So
I got in and that was game changer. I mean, living in Paris and going to that program and then working as an apprentice and, you know, a 3-star restaurant, a 1-star restaurant. And, you know, just that was it. Then I went to wine school and I was there too.
And this may kind of show my lack of knowledge in the dining realm, but why France? Like, why is that like the mecca?
Well,
why is that the?
It is because of what it is. It is, at least at that point, it was the most structured and organized culinary program in the world. Not just, I mean, they're very disciplined. They're very organized. It's very specific, and their training is very, very diligent and very specific and very organized.
Okay,
and so, I mean, there's other cuisines that are as are budding and more organized, you know, like the Japanese cuisine, Chinese for sure. But they're all come up now. I mean, everyone's,
sure.
I mean, in this country, we've really come a long, long way.
Yeah.
A long, long way.
It seems like the French background is like the classic background.
Well, because
right?
It is the most structured. I mean, basically everything, a 360 view at everything about food, from pastry to sauce, being a saucier or whatever it is you do, it is completely structured.
Yeah.
And the recipes around it, the foundations of it, the foundations of all sauces, you know, it's codified and it's documented and it's taught. So
systematic, right?
You're
able to put it into a system.
And
yeah,
even the kitchens are organized systematic. That was done by the French, by Escoffier. He's the one that's organized the modern day, the way we run kitchens. I mean, it's bleeding out now. Not many people do it, but it used to be also very specific about what you did and where you were and, you know, what station you had. And, you know, you grew into different stations and stuff.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Was it limited to just the cooking aspect? Did it like evolve out into like operations or anything like that?
Yeah. Yes, the front of the house is the same.
Okay.
Yeah, very structured. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is fascinating. I think I could talk this
guy
all
day.
Well,
it really shows his history, which I think you know you hear snippets in interviews, but to really get the background stories, I fascinated.
Yeah, I don't like to talk about it much. Is this thing on? Wait a second.
You know what? There was a moment where I was like, did I hit record? I've done that a couple times. Luckily, it's only been like 5 minutes in, but I'm like, do I just let it go?
And I'm glad you did, because I'd be like, what did I just say? I don't remember.
Yeah. Well, so you go to France then, right?
Yes.
And was it, where? What was it compared to what you expected?
Well, you know, I had no real expectations. I had been there once. I was very fortunate. We were involved a lot, outdoorsy family, you know, so we did a lot of hiking. And through this hiking group, my family went to Europe, and we went hiking in Switzerland when I was very young. I was 10. And, of course, then, as a 10-year-old boy, you're making fun of it mostly.
Yeah.
But my mom and her family, she had met someone when she was in college who was French. And they lived in Paris. So we went and visited them, and that was my first introduction to Paris. And, of course, at then it's just so grand and wild. And I remember we stayed in this tiny, tiny room with all of us in one bed, and it had a Turkish toilet. I don't know if you know what that is, but there's just a hole in the ground. and out our window, which we had a tiny little sliver of a window, all it was the back of a church where most of the people that drank a lot of wine and slept there. They call them clochard.
Okay.
There's a term.
We call them
that.
Winos. But yeah, so that was my view of Paris, although I went to, you know, some of the sites and stuff. And then, it kind of sparked something in me that I wanted to go back. I don't know why. And I really no reason to go back or means to go back, but I did. So it was wild because, you know, here I am, I'm 18 and I turned 19 and went to Paris very young. I didn't think I was very young at the time, but looking on it now, I was very young. I
thought you knew everything, but basically.
Of course I did. Well. I've forgotten everything now, but the way life goes. But so it was a world. And, you know, I had also no money. And I lived in this very small apartment. Well, it wasn't even an apartment. It had a sink and a small bed. And I'm a small guy, and my feet stuck out the end. I mean, that's how small the bed was. I don't think you can call it a bed.
Yeah.
And we shared, there were 20 of them, and we shared one bathroom and one shower, another Turkish toilet. So it was a very, you know, humble place to be. But I didn't live in my apartment. I lived outside.
Sure.
I was very busy with school and doing my externships, and I was very busy. And then I started to go to wine school. And so I was always gone. And then when I wasn't doing all of that, I was out with friends, or, you know, we'd stay up all night, you know, typical 19-year-old stuff in the city.
Yeah.
So we, you know, I didn't sleep much, and, you know, I didn't really care.
Yeah.
But it's all about the experiences.
Yeah. I didn't
care.
Yeah.
You would regret it if you hadn't done that, right?
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
I can't imagine it. Then I thought, I didn't really think much about it, to be honest, because I was so focused on the work and it was very intense.
Yeah.
But upon reflection, I'm so fortunate that I did that, because there's very few times in your life you can just go, I'm going to go to Paris and go to school.
Sure. Yeah.
Or anywhere, even New York or Chicago or whatever. It becomes more challenging as life goes on.
Yeah, absolutely. So what, from there, you get through school?
Yes, I got through school. Yes, I did, miraculously. I was on time, and I ended up staying longer in Paris. And I worked in restaurants under the table. You know, they have very strict immigration laws there as well. But it was very difficult, and they started cracking down on anyone who was not a native or resident of France.
So you could go as a student.
Go as a student, no problem, just like here.
But
but they were cracking down. So they were starting to, you know, and I had other friends who had stayed in Paris. So we started to feel the weight, you know, of coming and their stories, you know, of them cracking down. So and sending people away. So I stayed for as long as I could. And then I, you know, realized my future and my career was in the United States. I did want to stay in France. I wanted to live there.
I'm glad he came.
I know.
I asked like 10 people to marry me, but they all said no. They're like, I know why you want to marry me. I said, really?
I will cook for you.
Yes, right. I'll do anything for you.
See, talk about regret. They all regret that.
I don't know if they regret it. I think they were smart. They're like, I can tell what you're doing, you stupid American.
So you decide then at that point, like, because there was, like you said, there was nothing in the U.S. that was, like, did you have this, like, you know, the superhero kind of thing, like, I'm going to take cuisine to the United States kind of?
Yes. I mean, of course, you know, when you have that training, it's pretty intense, and you work in those great kitchens, you do think that you know some stuff, and you do have skills, for sure.
Sure.
But I was really more focused on doing what I need to do to open a restaurant, because that was my number one goal. So I came back, and I did you know, work, because the last place I worked was Willie's Wine Bar, which is still there.
Oh, Martin, I've been there.
You have?
Yes.
Mark Williamson.
That's iconic in Paris.
It is Willie's? Iconic. Yes.
I thought you were talking about here in Phoenix.
And I think it lives up to it.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
really cozy.
It's amazing. Yeah.
Wait, this is in...
In Paris.
Oh, okay. I was like, yeah. wait, is this in Phoenix?
Mark,
like,
Mark Williamson owned it. He's an English English person, but he specialized in Rhone wine, which was quite unusual then, and then, you know, really interesting food. So I actually did an apprenticeship there, but I also worked behind the bar there, which is my first outside of the kitchen experience. Terrifying. Yeah. Now, I was just helping. I was a runner. I'd go downstairs and get wine, and, you know, I just ran around and cleaned dishes. But I remember one time Mark Williamson told me to go down and get a specific wine, and he said it like five times. And he goes, it's really important. So I go down to the cellar, like down this narrow stone staircase, and I go into the cellar, and I looked at two of the wines that looked very similar to what he said. I picked one and I dropped one.
Oh boy!
And being who I am, I went back to him, and I knew he was just going to literally pick me up and throw me out the door because it was like a very expensive wine. And he goes, no problem. And I was like, that is so cool.
Wow.
Yeah.
That was impactful, obviously.
It was very impactful. I thought it was done, but I did admit it. I just said, hey, you know, I broke a bottle, and it was this bottle.
Yeah.
And he goes, well, thank you for telling me. No problem. Don't do it again.
Yeah.
And I was like, I never. Yeah. Like, I'm never going down there.
Right. Yeah. Don't do that ever. Well, he probably never asked you again, right?
It was wild, and I work in the kitchen. So I had this idea because I was very into food and wine pairing, which was a new thing then back in the early 80s. And so I wanted a wine bar because I wanted to put the two together. And so I worked at the best wine bar in the Boston area in Cambridge near Harvard. It's called Vintage Wine Bar and Restaurant, but it was really a restaurant more than a wine bar. What made it a wine bar is they were the first to have one of those cuvées, which had, I think, 20 bottles, which was miraculous back then.
What is that? What is it?
Well, it was a preservation system, but also a tap. So you would put a bottle in it, and it would replace the space with nitrogen, but it would also pressurize it with nitrogen, so you could put a great bottle of wine, like the best Bordeaux and the best wines in the world, to be preserved, but you could have one glass of it. So it was a big thing then. It's like the Cuvenet now, but it was a machine.
And this was back in the 80s, huh?
Yeah, they were the first one and only one in Boston to have one, so I picked that place to work, and I was in the kitchen.
Sous chef.
Yes, a little bit. Yeah, okay. they were a little bit loosey-goosey. But so I worked for a great female chef. She was Italian, so it was an Italian restaurant, essentially. It was her food. And eventually,
what was the name of the chef?
It was Vintage Wine Bar and Restaurant, and her name, I'll get it. I can't remember. It was Marianne, and I can't remember Scarfetto. We still stay in touch, and I apologize. My memory's a little foggy. But she was great, and she was such a character, and I love working with her, and it was intense and very busy. And I realized at that point, well, I became the chef. She left after a while, and I was a chef for a few months. And then I worked at a bakery. Work. That's boring. I worked at a lot of places. But
part of the story, though, right? Like, it is. Yeah, yeah. Like, I know. Yeah.
But one of the profound things was, my goal to open a restaurant, I realized that all these people running in there, picking up food, were servers, hair on fire, freaking out. You know, then it was, you know, everyone in the kitchen was taught to torture them, especially if they were stressed.
Yeah.
And I was like, what do they do? You know, like, because I'm just a kitchen guy, right?
Yeah.
And I go, I think I need to learn what they do if I'm going to do a restaurant. So it kind of brought me on a path eventually to get a job in the front of the house, it's called. It took me a while to find one, but I found one at Deer Valley Ski Resort in Park City, Utah, at Cafe Mariposa, which is a fine dining, which was a really great restaurant at the time, still is, but it was one of the top 10 in the country at the time. And, it was really crazy. It was in Utah. And so I convinced them that I had this wine pedigree, and I did their wine program and wine education.
Yeah.
So
you were a very convincing guy.
Yes. I did go to wine school, so I did have a little knowledge, but it was a little bit of a stretch.
Yeah.
I had no idea how to run a restaurant. But they were great. And I was an assistant manager, and they took me under their wing, and I really was aggressively pursuing the wine program, which was fun. It was awesome. I mean, it was the day when, like, Robert Redford, everyone's too young to know who that is in this
podcast. I remember.
Yeah. Okay, well, he would fly in his helicopter. I mean, like, all the stars of the time would come to that restaurant if they were skiing there. It was pretty cool. None of which you would know.
I might. I'm 42. I know this is my boy. I just shaved today, so I look a little younger. But
Anyway, it was cool, but it was intense, and I loved the intensity. I hated it because it wasn't like the kitchen, and it wasn't as real as the kitchen to me, but I learned to love the how much of a Rubik's Cube it is to put together every night and try to make everybody happy and get all the tables right and get the turns right and get the everyone working in sync and all the things you had to do. It was really fascinating. And so, and they were great. But the guy that ran that ended up coming down to open the boulders in Carefree, and he asked me to come down and work for him, and that's how I got to Arizona.
That's how the Arizona trip, yeah.
I knew you worked at the boulders, but I didn't know that's what brought you here.
Yes, it was Bill Nasikas, who now
who
does Sanctuary,
love,
yes.
And actually, I've been to wine dinners here with Bill at our table.
He's amazing.
So hello, Bill.
Hello, Bill.
Looks like we need to get Bill on the podcast
you
at
do.
Some point,
actually,
too.
Yeah. He has
Bill
stories.
Is, yeah. And he's a wonderful person.
Yeah, and talk about stories. I mean, he worked at... Yeah, I mean, he also went to Swiss Hotel School. I won't get it. I'm not going to do Bill's interview, but it's great.
Swiss
great
Hotel story. School.
He did.
That sounds which was that sounds fancier than French Culinary School.
It was. It was the best in the world. Absolutely best in the world, yeah.
So he's got that side of it. That the would that be hospitality side?
Yes.
I guess it's all hospitality.
He went to Cornell, then to the Swiss Hotel School. Wow. So it's like, okay, I'm going to be great and greater.
Great. So had you been to Arizona before you?
No.
Before you
when I got the offer, it was... fascinating because I'm like, it's the desert. I knew it was desert. So I'm thinking camels, I had no clue. I mean, literally, I took it on faith and was so blown away by the beauty of the desert because I'm more of a mountains ocean person, but the desert has sort of an ocean spirit quality
to
it.
Yeah.
It's very, very vast and it's very peaceful and serene. So I was up in Carefree in Boulders at the time, so it was nobody there. I mean, in 1986, it was, it was dark until like Shea.
Yeah.
I know it's hard to imagine now, but.
But that was the draw of the place, though, right?
And it's so pretty up there.
Yeah. Those rocks are like, I took my kids up there. My daughter's like, what are those? My one daughter, she's like, she gets scared. Where are we? We're still on Earth. Like, yeah, we're still on Earth. Yeah.
Yeah. It felt that way.
Yeah. So how was that? Like, I mean, you
amazing.
Were your way
so
out there.
So Rusty Lion was a fantastic. He was the owner, and he's iconic in Arizona for a lot of things. He owned a lot of land. He developed Scottsdale Fashion Square and Biltmore and Metro Center and the Buttes and just a, he did a lot, mostly in malls. But he built this. It was a dream and passion project for him, and it was right. He lived very close by, and. It was 116 casitas that they were all designed by Bob Bacon, who was an artist. And so it had this really special organic feel about it. And we were also the most expensive per night, room in all of the country. So average room rate. And we also were voted number one in the world 6 years out of the 8 I was there.
Wow.
The team that was involved, Bill Nasikas leading it and Dick Holtzman, who's amazing as well. It ran the montage thing for a while. These guys were at the top of their game, and everybody was. And so I was a part of that team, and there was no no's. It was just like anything to take care of the guest was a yes.
Yeah.
And so we were able to do the craziest things. I mean, like one time someone wanted to propose to his wife and do something unusual, so we rented the entire Suns Arena, and we flew him down by helicopter, had a limo drive him into the floor of the Suns, built an Italian restaurant complete with music, and he proposed to and she said yes, thank you, but that would have been bad. But we were there, we were always like, what if he says no, and we did all this. Would that be bad?
That's incredible though, like that's
we just
that's
did the experience. Craziest things and that was amazing, so.
Yeah. Well, Christine, when did you move to Phoenix area?
2008.
Okay, so bridge that gap for us, Mark. Right.
So from 8 to now.
Yeah.
21?
Well, no. Like so. No. So you get you're at Boulders, right?
Oh, okay.
And like,
so
where does
just had two jobs. So Boulders, and then I had a career with them and an opportunity. They wanted me to take over the number 2 slot. They just bought the Peaks at Telluride, a hotel up there, and I saw my path in the road, and I love the hotel business, and I love that company, and I love the people in it. But my burning passion from the time I was 18 was to open my own place.
Yeah.
So I took a leap, and I had nothing. I had no money. I had nothing. So what I did was gave them a year's notice, and then
at Boulders.
Mm-hmm,
okay.
December 31st, the turn of 1994 was December January 1st. I had nothing, and so I had no location. I had nothing. So I did everything. I sold everything, cashed in my 401k. And then convinced, I was able to borrow some money as well, which wasn't easy for restaurant business.
Yeah.
And that was it. And I went looking for a space. And I had one fully designed up on 32nd Street. And the deal fell apart at the last minute, and I was then now deep into it, about 5 months into it or so. And I drove by this space, and there was a restaurant here, and I just had this spidey sense that, should I talk to the landlord? The landlord was like, it's great. Everything's great. We don't want a restaurant. You're get out of here, you know, whatever.
Like, there was a restaurant, and then it was gone, and he's like,
No, I don't want another one. It was running. It was called Tapas Papas Fritas. And he said, oh, it was perfect. You know, get out. We hate restaurants, whatever. you're annoying me. Henry Fuchs was his name. And then about a week later, he called me. He goes, well, I'll have coffee with you. And just entertain me with your idea.
Yeah.
And so I did, and one thing led to another, and this restaurant hadn't, you know, it was leaving.
Yeah.
And so I came in, and the rest is history. That was 26 years ago.
Well, what was this like 26 years ago, this 32nd Street in Camelback?
It was the same. I mean, yeah? This thing was built in 56. Okay. I mean, frankly, it hasn't changed a bit. But, I mean, we paved it a little bit this summer. But anyway, the culinary scene wasn't even nearly as developed as it is now.
Sure.
I mean, when I in the 80s, it was all about hotel restaurants. So, and that's where all the best chefs were, and that's where all the best restaurants were. And there were some great ones, you know, like Rob McGrath, and then Alex Strada up at Mary Lane's was like world-class restaurants. Unbelievable. The Point Tapatio had a grand award. You know, wine program was like insane. So independent restaurants, it was basically Christopher, Roxanne, Vincent. Vincent was the godfather of all. He's the one that started it. Yeah, that was kind of it. You know, okay. It was kind of a, you know, three PO. There was others, but, you know, it's essentially that.
Yeah.
So I was coming in as a new kid, and I, you know, I'll tell this story. A couple months before I open, Vincent calls me up and says, you know, welcome. Can I do anything? We knew each other a little bit, but can I send you over some staff to help you open? You know, do you need tablecloths? I mean, he was just so gracious.
So gracious.
And we've been very good friends ever since. And that was it. You know, I just opened, and my first goal was, my number one goal was to stay open.
Yeah.
My number two goal was to be the third best restaurant in Arizona. And my number three goal was refer back to number one, stay open.
Right, yeah.
I think you were one of the first ones to kind of introduce this dining at the bar culture,
yes,
and to source locally.
Yes.
I think to me.
Yeah, thanks. It is, because it may seem very normal to have a third of your restaurant taken up by a bar, but in 94, it was not. First of all, bars were for smoking and drinking, and this was a non-smoking restaurant from day one because of the layout. Not because I didn't think, you know, whatever. I mean, it just wouldn't work. And so that was a big challenge. I mean, I had people come in screaming at me saying, you'll never work, I can't smoke, and this is ridiculous, it's a bar. And I'm like, well, it's a dining counter. And then the three eyes are coming out of their head, and they're like ready to choke me. Dining counter, it looks like a bar to me, there's booze.
Are you trying to sweet talk me?
Yeah. You come in with your fancy ideas and crazy man from the city. Yeah. But so I called it a dining bar from the beginning because I love to eat at bars. It's my thing, right?
Yeah.
So I did it very selfishly. But the true story is, for the first almost 3 months, not one person sat at that bar.
Really?
Not one. And I was open for the first 8 months, lunch and dinner. And I was like, people would walk by and look at it. And then they go to a table. And they'd look at it and go to a table. Of course, the people that would come in and try to smoke, they'd come in and leave. But
yeah,
that didn't work. But then finally, one guy named Mr. James, he had a advertising or insurance company, I think, just up the street. He sat right down there alone and had lunch. Then the next day, and I said, he didn't say much. And I said, thanks for coming. He goes, great, that's great. Next day he came with two other people. And then it just went, it was like that.
So he was the pioneer of your dining
bar. I'll never forget him, Mr. James.
Mr. James, good for him. I was going to say Sweet James. That was Sweet James.
Yeah.
It was a different
one. No, not him. No. That's kind of,
when we moved here, we always like to eat at the bar. I like to, you know, pick the bartender's knowledge and wine pairings and all that. And when we first came here, there's a restaurant in Boston that we always was our regular spot in the North End. Shout out to Prezza and Chef Anthony Catarano. But that was our regular spot to eat at the bar. Again, it was fine dining like this, but Ernesto could watch the game and I could have, you know, white truffle pasta. But the minute we walked in here the very first time, it had that same vibe. And so I thought it was so fascinating that you in a whole different state had created that same kind of feeling where you just want to be a regular. Mm. You want to hang out here. You know, it's upscale but very comfortable. So.
Yeah.
Thank you. That's Can you say that again? Because no, no, but that's exactly that's what I wanted. It was I wanted it to be an everyday place, and so my third best restaurant in Phoenix was for two reasons. One, I didn't want it to be precious, and for only for anniversaries and birthdays and events, and that was very important to me. And the other thing is, I noticed that all the 5-star reviews in the Arizona Republic, which was a make it or break it at the time, there was newspapers, kids.
Yeah,
they were cute. They throw them on your door. You go, the dog would go pick them up, bring them in. But the newspaper was the most powerful source of media, and it would make or break restaurants. So I noticed that all the 5-star restaurants lasted between 1 and 3 years. In my observation. So I was like, I don't want to do that. I like the 3-star restaurants. They last forever.
So when you said that, I was thinking, all right, were there two other ones that you didn't think you were going to be better than?
No.
But it was like, nah, there's...
I wanted to be great, but... You know,
yeah. It was strategic.
Just great every day, very, great.
Yeah, strategic.
And I wanted to be open, so I put salmon on the menu, which I didn't, you know, I planned to at first. You know, I, of course, was still a little Frenchy.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm not going to put a steak or salmon on the menu, and everyone, or a Caesar salad. And everyone was like, that's a bad idea. You're in Arizona, son.
Those things are kind of not shunned, but kind of?
Well, I think they're shunned by chefs.
Okay.
You know, by people that, you know, whatever. I think, you know, maybe a real foodie might think of them, less of them.
Yeah.
But, it, you know, the fact of the matter is, you know, they stay. You know, salmon pays for my truffles.
Sure.
You know, yeah. Let me just put it bluntly.
Let me write down that quote.
Yeah. And it's delicious. Maybe I'm just not grasping. Like, what is the issue, like, with steak or salmon?
Comment on this.
Well, I think because it's just such a familiar dish.
Yeah.
It's like ordering chicken.
Boring.
And like again, not to take away, I mean.
From Tuwash Ranch.
Right. Yes. Yeah. I can name 3 places that have the most fantastic chicken, like Trotto.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
But I think it's like I wouldn't go in and order salmon because it's kind of ubiquitous everywhere.
So that gotcha.
And the same with the steak. You know, gotcha. I would go for, ooh, what's Mark's special tonight? Or, you know, what is seasonal and what came in? That kind of thing.
That's great. That's true. Yeah. And that's what people want that, right? They're like, what is new? What is different? Like Tammy with Cotton and Copper. Like that. People
but
love.
But see, like Ernesto will come in and have the same dish every time. He loves that.
Yeah.
So, you know, it depends on what you want.
The philosophy behind this, and I tell chefs that want to open places, is you need a welcome mat. You need a roadmap and a welcome mat. You need something that says, I feel comfortable here. That then maybe I will try something besides salmon.
Sure.
But if there's nothing that's comforting on the menu, you will define your audience, but it might be more narrow.
Sure.
And as we are growing to be very cosmopolitan, and so many other restaurateurs can do what they want to do now. That's a privilege, and that's been earned over time, that the city accepts that and it works. But back in the day in 94, if you didn't understand that, you know, there had to be some simpleness to it and some familiarity to it.
Yeah.
Or it just was, people would try it once and go, oh, that was nice.
Yeah.
But it was uncomfortable. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think your Scottish salmon became a signature dish, too, didn't it?
Scottish salmon. Wow.
Well, it was, I don't know how much time we have, but can I tell the salmon story?
Yeah, okay, absolutely. Great. We have all
so the
time.
So the salmon story is kind of funny because it really, I tripped into it. So a month before I opened, we did a birthday party for a friend of mine in LA. It was his wife's 35th birthday. And, you know, it was just the thing, and there was nothing here. The bar wasn't here. So we tilted up drywall all around. We put candles in here, and we had a guitar player friend of mine, Kevin McNally, came in and played. And we all dressed in tuxes, and, you know, it was really kind of cool. But it was a construction site.
Yeah.
And we didn't have a kitchen, so I rented a grill, you know, rolling on rollers. And we were going to do this dish, Kevin said, my wife doesn't like fish, but she'll eat salmon if it isn't fishy. And I was like, ooh, okay. you know, challenge, but I can handle
it. Sure.
So what I did is I created this salmon dish where I grilled it, and then I made this four-ingredient glaze. It was Arizona honey, molasses, ancho chili puree, which we made, ancho chili puree, and lime juice. And a little bit of salt, so 5 ingredients. So when it came off the grill, I brushed it with that, which had acid, bitterness, salt, sugar, you know, really kind of knocked down anything.
You
could put it on anything, it would make it, right? Pull it together. And then I, you know, she wanted it to be light, so I made a salad under it with just a lemon olive oil vinaigrette. And then everyone likes crispy, crunchy, so I made a potato cake, but it was just done with clarified butter. So it was butter, salt, potatoes. Can't be wrong, right?
No.
I basically went.
Do you see my mouth?
I went right down the.
We're both like.
Well,
I'm
went
hungry.
Down the middle of, you know, like middle of the lane. Like
yeah.
I didn't even need. I couldn't see the guardrails. I was so far in the middle.
Yeah.
So I did this for her, And then, as I said, I wasn't going to put salmon on the menu. And some my people around me that I trusted said, you're making a big mistake. So I was here with Chef Mark Bloom, and I'm like, you remember that thing we did, you know, for the, you know, for that birthday thing? And he's like, yeah. I said, let's just do that to open. Well, 25 years later, I'm doing the same salmon.
25 years.
Three times I tried to take it off. Once I moved, bought my first house nearby here. I was walking my dog. Neighbor goes, Mark Turrell, nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. It was very nice to meet you. Why'd you take the salmon off? And I was like, I got in my car, drove back, put the salmon back on. Next one.
I rue that salmon.
Next one, I tried to make some version of it out of the wood oven. You know, trying to be a chef. changing it a little bit.
Well, it's your fault for making it so in the beginning, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so, and that didn't work. And that's a Jerry Colangelo story. So he came in one day with a couple of guys, and, you know, I thought, oh no, this is it. So Jerry comes in, and he had a sit down with me. I don't know if you know Jerry, but you know the name. You
know,
Jerry's
I know the name.
The word sit down rings bells.
Yeah, so Jerry was the one that brought the Suns to Arizona and brought the championship and blah, 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 and created the Arizona Diamondbacks and won 3 gold medals for the basketball, USA basketball. Great guy. Anyway, so Jerry comes in, and he's very powerful, and he's like, wants to sit down. He's like, you took the salmon off. I said, no. It's going to be on tonight. And so the last one was also involving some customers where I had this idea. Remember when agave syrup was healthy?
Yeah.
So for a moment, I took the Arizona honey and made it agave syrup.
Yeah.
And I had 3 customers come in and go, there's something wrong with your salmon.
Oh, they could tell.
And
right
I was like,
away.
I can't believe they know my dish better than I do. Because I thought it tasted the same.
Well, yeah, you had to have tasted it, right?
Well, I thought it was the same. I was it's, you know, it's sweet. You know, it's honey-like thing.
Yeah.
So that was like, that's my salmon story. No,
well, that shows how imprinted it is on people's taste buds, that dish.
But wife will listen to this episode. She's like, we're going to Tarbell's.
Now, to be clear, we're not doing that salmon anymore.
What? COVID, again, you've taken COVID,
you cannot ask
No, COVID came. No, is on the secret menu. Shh, don't tell anyone.
I won't.
So you can
Except
get
for
it.
All the listeners.
But no one orders it anymore.
Right.
Yeah.
So now you'd mentioned, too, that he was a pioneer of the local produce. Or like you
like
utilizing
sourcing local.
Yeah. Yes. Why do you say that? Like, what was it that you saw from him?
He just saw the importance of it early on. And, you know, if you read anything about Mark's restaurants, that's a highlight, you know, to not only, you know, give it to the customers, but to support our local farmers. I know our mutual friend is Carl Seacat.
Right.
And so Carl will always send me, hey, guess what's at Mark's right now? But
awesome.
In the last issue of your magazine, Carl says, you know, we all should support the Tarbells of the world.
Oh, that's
because
nice.
Of that. Yes.
So, you know, the local thing was really being is from a chef, really. It wasn't so the origin of it was if it's grown here, it's going to be fresher and better and more, you know, there's going to be more stability. And also I like to very much keep, you know, the business in the community. I think that's important, especially as a small business person. I think that's important.
Yeah.
And so it was really Roxanne and Robert McGrath. You know, Roxanne was already well established and very forward in this kind of thinking. And so and then a couple of the hotel chefs like Alex, we all got together and said, we need to meet with farmers and we need to tell them what to grow. Cause we would just get a bunch of, you know, zucchini, like everyone's getting zucchini, like hundreds of pounds. So we basically helped then define what would work, what we could use and how much we could use. So it's a very important part of it. But at that time I had hired a guy in his white Chevrolet pickup truck. Cause he was growing gardens for nice homes in Arcadia and Paradise Valley, all organic. And I would buy from them. I think he stole the stuff from him and sold it to me on the side. But don't
got a
say
lot it. Of edits
yeah,
on
you
this
might
one.
Want to delete, yeah, you might want to delete that. Anyway, but he also would go to farms up in the Verde Valley, and it was very difficult to get it. And Blue Sky was here, but they were only doing commercial selling to bulk packagers in California. You know, the organic greens you get in the stores, and so they really we had to convince them to sell to us because it's really difficult to sell to restaurants in small batches, but they did. They were lovely about it. And then, of course, Pat Duncan, the Duncan Farms, they were early in on it, and they're great. So it became a thing where they started to do it, but it is difficult.
So you really had to seek it out
then
in the beginning.
We did. Yeah, now it's a lot easier, and there's so many more
micro-farmers.
Yeah. And over the years, there's been farmers that have been, it's just backyard things, fantastic farmers. Yeah, they come and go, you know, but we've had these moments where there's just been these glorious years where there's been great stuff. Currently, it's great. It's just competitive to get it because there's so many great chefs using local, and I think that's the way it should go. I think it'll drive more people into considering that as an avocation or what to do. So, but yeah, I was in it early. And so much so, the story is, like, when we wouldn't put organic on the menu here, the word organic, even if it was organic, which largely, you know, wherever we could do it, it was. Because at that time, we would be pigeonholed into a hippie restaurant.
That's interesting. Like co-op. Yes, that makes sense.
Again, you're also young. You don't know what that means. But, yeah, it was...
this
it was,
is in
it
the
was,
90s.
I think like, we're around the same age.
It was like a real thing in Arizona where, you know, like, organic, oh, it's sort of weird then. You know, so it might have bugs in it or something. I don't know. But there was no culture of dining where that would be supported and paid for. We just did it. I always like to tell my chefs, we basically made great food and we snuck it to them. You know, we sneak it up on them. And we would use... all the French technique and all the standards, but make it very simple looking.
Okay.
You know, like it took 4 days to make our sauce for the Scotch beef, but it looks like pot roast.
Yeah.
But it takes forever to make the dish.
But when you look at it, you don't...
It looks like, you know, meat and gravy. Yeah. Potatoes, fantastic. Yeah.
But meanwhile, you know, people are saying that's the best meat and gravy I've ever had.
Yeah. I mean, there's celebrities and musicians that I've traveled with it and are served backstage many times and our meatballs. And, you know, there's so many of those stories about our simple food.
Yeah.
You know, I always thought simple was good. Simplicity is a complex thing, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, talking about him backstage, so did you know that Mark's a musician too? It's the guitar you play?
I do.
Yes. I've seen, I follow him. I follow him on social media. I've seen him jam.
And I know you're not a big name dropper, but I know that you've jammed with some very famous people.
I've been very lucky. You know, I always had small goals and aspirations, you know, and I played a little bit as a kid. And then I stopped for all the years I was cooking and whatnot and growing the restaurant. And then it was about 10 or 12 years ago, I said, I need to want to play again, but I need a coach, you know. And I think I've learned that I need help over the years. Got a great coach, Doug Mann. And then from that, my goal was just to play once on stage in front of an audience, which is a scary goal.
Yeah.
Because I'd never done anything like that. Well, I did. I played with one of the Gin Blossoms my first time out at the Little Woody.
Was it Scotty?
No way.
Scotty, yes. Scotty and I did
Scotty,
three songs.
I've met, again, through Mark. You introduced me a long time ago, and we actually sat at an Arizona Cocktail Week dinner together here.
Scotty Johnson. Yes. Wow. Great guitar player.
And he's super nice.
Super nice.
From
one
Gin
of my
Blossoms.
Best buddies. Yes. Okay. He's a guitar player.
Yeah.
So we did a thing together, which was really fun. And then the next time was, you know, it just kept happening. And... over the years, I've played on stage with Nils Lofgren from the E Street Band, and I've played with Alice Cooper, and I've played... One of the wildest ones was a guy named Kris Kristofferson, who was the original Star Is Born. Not the original.
Yeah,
but
with Barbra
Streisand. But he was also a great songwriter. He wrote Me and Bobby McGee that was made famous by...
Oh, I did not know that.
He's more of a songwriter, but he became a famous... Kind of an actor, singer.
He's one of the... Was he one of the Outlaws?
He was one of the Outlaws.
Yeah, yeah.
Amazing, legendary guy in my world. So... I was supposed to cook dinner for him one night. This was just a couple of years ago, and he was going to come in, but one thing led to another. He didn't feel comfortable, and he wanted to do it at a private home, which I did. And through the course of the night, I think his wife said, "Do you play guitar?" And I was like, "Yeah." She goes, "Well, you should come play with Kris tomorrow. He's playing at the, you know."
Like, did I hear right?
And I was like, my usual, no. Like, I've always said no to things I should say yes to, and yes to things I should say no to. And this has been a pattern in my life. So I'm saying no to something I should say yes to. Yeah. And she's like, she insisted. And I said, well, you know, I'm 50 some odd years old. What the hell? They can't fire me.
Yeah.
I'll go do it. Yeah. So I said yes. And then I started the flop sweats, of course. So we picked a couple songs that he was going to do. And I just crammed that next day. It was a very stressful day because also busy at work. It was a Thursday. And so I crammed, and I didn't cram that well, but I did it. And then I go to the arena to go to sound check. Not the arena, but the venue.
Little Woody's?
No, this was at...
Oh, this is Kris Kristofferson.
This was at the casino.
Yeah, I was going to say, he's.
And so I'm walking up to the stage, and I'm like, there's no drums. Where's the equipment? And so I go backstage and I go to his wife. I said, well, where's the band? And she goes, you are the band.
Oh,
and I was
boy.
Like, man, you should have seen the sweat rings around
my...
Oh, my God. And I was like shaking, and I was like, I can't do that. You know, I thought I could hide, you know, behind the music. You know, maybe,
oh, yeah.
Maybe flutter a few notes or yeah. whatever. But I was like, oh, man. And, you know, I almost left. And she goes, you know, do sound check with Chris. And if it goes well, we'll tell you. I mean,
yeah,
you'll know. We'll know. And just try it.
Yeah.
So I was like, yeah, why not? So I did it. I passed the sound check. It did the, went on stage that night, just me and Chris. And I'm sitting up there just like, ding, ding, ding.
No, oh my but God. If you could do that, now you yeah. can do anything.
Yeah, it was
right?
crazy.
That's incredible, though. That's like a dream.
So yeah. your so, debut was with
well, I mean, no,
in
I,
such a
I,
huge
I,
venue.
Yes, yes. I yeah. mean, it was like, and then we opened up for Cheap Trick once with Nate Nathan's
oh,
band.
Oh, yeah.
That was fun.
Cheap anyway. Trick is my era.
Yes.
Up. He's coming in tonight, Rick
really?
Nielsen.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yes, he is.
I'd have to stick around for that
yeah,
one.
Yeah, you might have.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you meet any sort of people. I just yeah. recently met Alice Cooper, who, like Mark, is known for their philanthropy.
Yes.
And
yeah.
One
yeah.
Oh, wonderful person who founded the...
Solid Rock?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
school
Solid
for
Rock.
Underserved kids.
Yeah.
Okay.
Music school.
Unbelievable so. Guy. Cheryl Cooper is some of the nicest people ever. So we're so lucky to have them in our community, I can tell you. So
well, what may I mean? So that leads to a good question, and I do want to. We want to talk about a couple of the other
okay,
celebrities he's cooked for, right? But the Phoenix and the Arizona scene, right? So you've been here since you said early '80s, right?
Yes.
And to see that, and I don't know. I've been in the food and beverage scene for about 4 years now, mm-hmm. But when I talked with Christina, and you know, she's been in this a lot longer, and you as well. It's a really unique place. It's an mm-hmm. incredible. What have you seen over your years of where it's at?
I've seen it gone from being hopeful, like we hope that we're going to be something someday, to yeah. being legit and real. And it was just before COVID, it was exploding. It was just, yeah. you know, the snowball was getting bigger.
You think that was about the point, like where things were starting
no,
to catch or a little bit
no,
before?
No, before that. I mean, okay. I think the last 10 years have been very transformative. Okay. And I think especially the last five, wouldn't you
yeah.
agree?
You've definitely seen a leap. But And I yeah. know from, I've heard this from more than one that, right before COVID was set to be the best year
yeah.
that, you know, a oh, lot yeah. of chefs told me that.
Yeah.
And people were like, oh, had plans like this. Yeah. Oh, this was going to be a year that we were going to launch into fries with our beers and stuff like that.
Yep.
And, you know,
it's fantastic. I mean, yeah. and it just continues a little bit. But, you know, I know we'll all get out of this and I hope we'll be stronger for it. I do worry a great deal about our community, mm-hmm. the chefs and restaurant community. I know everyone's super stressed as I am. We're all faced with the same challenges and issues, but you know, all I do is go around and like Christina is just try to support and try to lift people up. I take phone calls, I give phone calls, I'll basically do whatever I can. I mean, we're all in the same boat. You know, I wish I could. Sometimes we'll do takeout for our staff occasionally, once a week or so, just to support restaurants. It's a small thing, really. Yeah. I wish I could. You know, I sometimes wake up in the morning and go, I wish I could just write a bunch of checks, you know, and
yeah.
help people out. But, you know, I've been in the restaurant business my whole career, so, you know, that ain't going to happen.
Yeah.
So, anyway, but you know, I just hope that with everything that's happening and the support that, you know, the country's been getting or will get, we'll be able to come out of this in somewhat of a whole form. You know,
I think people have realized the importance of supporting smaller
yes.
businesses and
yes.
supporting yeah. locals. So hopefully, as Mark said, we come out bigger, better, and stronger, but it's still heartbreaking.
Yeah.
All the people we've lost or going to lose.
Yes. Stressful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
And frankly, selfishly, it's horrible because I was really like, I was just so enjoying the opportunity and the diversity and the you know, just it was just becoming an exciting city to be in where you could just get a variety of all kinds of tastes and experiences
yeah.
and passion-driven owners and chefs that had a specific idea that were doing it. I mean, to me, that's beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
It's like people, living art.
Yeah. It, well, and like what you said with using the produce locally and you know, even chefs like Brett and Tammy that are
yeah, they're great.
Taking it even further where they're, you know, they're foraging. And mm-hmm. I don't know if you saw it today, but Tammy's going to be moving to Utah.
Yes, I actually messaged her last night.
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah.
So you, the place that you had mentioned, she's going to work at a place, a restaurant in Utah on okay. a lake, something Deer Valley. You had mentioned.
Oh, Silver Lake and Deer Valley?
I don't know if it's, oh. I can't remember. It was in AZ Central, but
okay.
I saw that she was going to, and when you mentioned that, I'm like, wait, Deer Valley,
well,
Utah?
Well, that must be, you know, in Park City.
Yeah.
I don't know. But
I don't know. Is that right on the lake or something?
Well, there's a thing called Silver Lake there, and it's in, you know, of course, Salt Lake.
I think that might be it, yeah.
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 So
we'll have to
We'll see.
But it's really cool to see like
that's,
people really.
That's impressive. Terrible.
Yeah,
I know.
I'm gonna be honest with you.
Yeah,
she's one of my favorite chefs.
Yes,
she absolutely.
Oh my gosh, she's so talented, and she's just such a great person. And yeah. You know, and you talk about Brett. I mean, this person's got to write a book. I mean, I don't know if he'll write a book, but. My
did
gosh.
You get to see Brett last night?
I did.
We had a get together, bonfire, yeah. And Brett was there. He's going to walk across the country
Arizona
to raise
Trail.
Money.
It's awesome. Barefoot. He texts me. He's like, "I'm going to do it barefoot." I'm like, "Are you serious?" He's like, "Have I ever lied to you?" I'm like, "Nope, you have not, Brett. Yeah. You've never."
He knows more about this desert and how to forage out of it than anyone that I've ever met. And he's so. Singularly passionate and focused about it. I just
yes.
focused and passionate.
And
yeah.
very generous and very helpful to the community. Yeah. He does a lot of volunteer work.
Yeah. Awesome.
It's cool to see this. Like, you know, I was with the beer community for 3 years, like specifically, you know, and then I met Tammy and then you met Brett and I started getting into the food. I'm like, all right, I love beer, but I love food. Like, so not even close. But to see, cause that was kind of the thing with the beer scene too. Cause it really has all started in the last 5 years with the law change. So all these brewers are pretty new. But it's cool to see that community. And now that I'm expanding into food, that there's that larger community where, you know, everybody still is, it's a very supportive community, which is kind of surprising.
And it's true. And it's gone through phases, but it's always been my dream and I had nothing to do with it for us to be together. Because one of the things I'm very, very clear on is that we are not in competition with each other in the restaurant business. There are, you know, 365 nights a week, people can go out. If you have a really good customer, they come in once, maybe twice a month. That's a regular.
Sure.
Maybe even, let's say once a week, 52 times a year. That leaves over 300 nights a year. And communities can absorb so much. And what I really am grateful for is we all support each other and like each other because we're in a common effort, if you will.
Sure.
And my desire is to basically be better than LA and be better than Nevada. Like Las Vegas is draw a lot of people. Denver's got a great food community and, you know, Santa Fe. And these are our competitors as other places. Cause the more people we can draw in because of what we do collectively into this valley, the better we will all do. That's just a fact.
Yeah.
So, you know, instead of trying to, you know, scramble over who's here, let's try to draw more in and make the community. And also I think it looks very good from people outside seeing us all getting along.
Yeah.
I think that I've always felt that a divisive community is not very attractive. It's certainly not hospitable, and that's the business we're in, hospitality. So that's always been my message about how you approach what we do. Because, you know, that it just battling with each other is senseless. You know, it doesn't work. So it's my thing.
And I think that's part of why Phoenix is so special.
I'm going to drop the mic now.
Yeah.
But you're the guest.
He's going to unplug you. Hear all this noise. He's unplugging it. I'm cranking this. Takes a while to drop these mics, but
I won't do it. They're beautiful mics.
Thank you. So we've got so many things. Like if Christina wrote some notes about all the things you've done. I don't. Where do we go? Do we talk about his wine next? Well, you are drinking wine. He brought me into a fantastic glass of wine
as
well.
We can get you more if you want.
I know that you've judged for that prestigious wine competition.
I have at the Los Angeles International Wine Competition. I like saying that; it just sounds so awesome.
Yeah,
but we really are in this giant convention room, you know, with can't talk, can't speak, can't hang, and we're tasting wines from 8 o'clock in the morning to 2 p.m. Oh, thank you.
I was just passing
85 Grand Esjuzo from Domaine de la Romanée Conti.
That was a very
casual. Because this just happens to Mark.
Yeah, they just brought him.
You know what it tastes like? Well, $10,000. No, I'm kidding. Wow, that's fantastic.
Even the color, you
around.
Can tell.
Yeah, it's old. 1985.
I can taste this?
Sure.
Oh, I thought you said pass it around.
I'm pretty sure I don't have COVID, but I can put some in here.
Yeah, sure. I don't mind either way. So this is a glass of what I'm about to taste here.
Yeah, so that's 1985 Grands Esjuzo, which is a Grand Cru vineyard by a winery named Domaine de la Romanée Conti.
Good thing that we have a camera on, so
we
got your facial expression.
You were staring at me the whole time.
I did. I wanted to see what you...
This is incredible. This is a Burgundy?
Yes, it's 100% Pinot Noir, red Burgundy. It's also the hardest to get and most collectible wild wine currently in the world.
So I asked you the question how much a glass of this would be, and then I tasted it, and I just stopped listening.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, that's how much it costs.
Yeah.
There is no price.
There is.
But, okay, so it would be arguably... I mean, somewhere around $4,000 a bottle, maybe $5,000 a bottle.
Man, so I feel real 25 special.
Ounces
I'm
to
bragging about
25
this
ounces
time.
To a bottle. So do the math.
Well, that's incredible. So, in from my, I think my limited palate, maybe sometimes that's an advantage. I love beer, and I love the like spontaneous fermentation, like a wild ale, a sour, and that's got something in it that has that. I don't know if you ever had Jester King out
yes.
of Austin.
And so you have a great palate, and that came from drinking those sours. That is exactly right. And the Pinot does express that, in fact,
okay.
especially as it ages. This is an older wine. So 85, what are we, 35-ish years? Can't
wow.
do the math.
Yeah, well, I'm 42, and I was born in 78, so 35, yeah.
Yeah, yeah it's about 35 years, yeah. So which is extraordinary in itself to have a 35-year-old wine. But, yeah. Yeah, it's about $1,000 a glass or maybe.
So I should go towards Pinot Noirs then if I like that. Like I should explore that.
Yes, I think okay. you will. I mean, obviously the world of Pinot is very diverse and varied. You're going to have to probably stick to Oregon and Burgundy.
Okay.
If you want more, and Burgundy especially if you want that character.
Okay.
Whereas Napa is going to give you much more lush forward characters, more fruit forward character
gotcha.
Of Pinot. And, you know, most of the New World wines are like that. So, but a nice Bourgogne, you don't have to get an expensive one, but just okay. get from a good producer. Bourgogne just means it's from that region or that county, if you will. It's not a county, but from that region. So they can pull grapes from anywhere.
Okay. And,
but you'll get, if it's with a good winemaker, it'll be a very good wine and also reasonably priced.
Okay.
Because Burgundy is not reasonable.
Right.
He makes it all so easy to understand.
I yeah. know, that's he really does. That's yeah. And that, I think that's true mastery, right? If you can explain it to somebody like me to understand it. Like, okay, well, that makes
and
sense.
And you've mentored sommeliers.
Yes.
I know you've,
yes, we, yes. You know, over the years. And, you know, I was telling, we had a master sommelier, Carlton McCoy was in last night, a couple nights ago. And he was the youngest master. At 28, he passed.
Wow.
He's a rock star. But anyway, we were talking about it because he's very young. And I remember in the 80s, in the early days, you know, when the Court of Master Sommeliers was first established in the United States, it was very small. I mean, there were two or three masters at that time. And I thought, well, I should do this, you know. And I got advice. Mark, you already have the job that we are doing this to get.
That's right.
And I was like, okay, good point.
That's true.
And why, they're like, why would you do that? But I regret, I don't have many regrets, but this is one because then it was like Burgundy, a little bit of California. There's
right.
some of that stuff called Riesling sort of in Germany, but don't pay too much attention to that.
Yeah.
And Italy, Tuscany primarily, and Barolo. So it was really much more simple, not easy to become a master then. Now it's like, everything that's made anywhere in the world that has something to do with alcohol and service and glassware.
Because one of the tests of a
that.
Master, you have to taste the wine and say what year yeah. it was made, where it was grown.
What
wow.
year.
Yeah.
You know, everything about it.
And
all
describe
the,
it. Accurately
describe its, you know, its attributes.
Blind.
Blind.
Ah,
blind. Yes.
Jeez.
It is the barrier.
Incredible.
The barrier to become a master today. I just tip my hat to them. I mean, they have to really dedicate their life. It's almost like becoming a brain surgeon. I mean, you have to dedicate your life exclusively to the effort of
yeah.
passing this test. And the chances are very slim you're going to pass.
Yeah. So people kind of bank their future, kind of like, this is what I'm going for.
I don't know what... I think the wine is so... it's just so fascinating because it's so rich in culture and history and people and geography and science and farming is that it's almost like it never ends. I've just scratched the surface and I went to wine school, I don't know, whatever, a lot of years ago.
Yeah.
So anyway, so 35 or 6 years ago. So it really is something that is special. And I get why people can become singularly focused on it and make it their career. But, you know, it is a life.
Yeah.
You know, I always say I love food and I have a passion for wine. Because if I love wine, that'd be a problem.
Yeah. It's true. Well, when it's this good, too, it's like, yeah,
yeah.
you got to have some self-discipline.
Yeah, you're spoiled now. Now you're
I
only
know.
Going to like,
yeah.
she knows.
Yeah.
What Bergen. Year is this?
Not 85.
90? What?
90. No. Too young. It's a baby. Yeah. It's a baby.
So you, the first, I think the first time I'd seen you was Plate and Pour. So mm-hmm. I was a big fan of Check Please with is it Robert?
Robert McGrath. Yes.
I grew up with a kid named Richard McGrath, so I get him confused. But love the show. Always loved his different crazy shirts and his bolo ties. And
he's crazy.
Yeah.
I love him.
Yeah. Well, he's a quirky
oh, yeah.
guy.
He's actually has a very funny, very dry sense of
yes.
humor. I was able to judge a cooking competition with him once.
He's a wonderful
pretty
guy.
Entertaining.
And an amazing chef.
Well, yeah. We were fans of him, and when we like this guy comes on, we're like, wait, who's this? Who's this? We like Robert.
Yeah. So, I got a lot of that the first year. Yeah. Tough crowd.
Then we gave it a chance. We're like, all right, this guy's pretty cool.
That was interesting. You know, I've done a lot of TV, and I actually auditioned for it. First time I've auditioned for anything. Typically I told you I'd say no to things I should say yes to. I said no to auditioning for months.
Like they invited you to audition?
Yes, and I kept saying no, and they kept asking, you know, and I'd forget about it, and then they'd ask again. And finally, my wonderful partner and assistant, she wasn't a business partner, but she worked for me for 22 years, Ann Ballman, she said, Mark, I think you should try this. So I was the last one to audition. They actually waited another 3 weeks for me to clear my schedule, because I'm very important, to do it. And I auditioned, and I remember it. Because they were like, do you want to do some, we're going to do some practice runs, you know, because I had to interview people. It was a mock, and there was filming and lights and everything. And they're like, yeah, you should go through a few run-throughs and interview. And I was like, no, let's just do it. And I was like, I was bored. I want to get out of there.
Yeah.
So I was like, no, I'll start to interview him now. No problem. I interviewed him. I did it. It was totally fun. And they go, you're hired. And I was like, cool. I didn't even know there were other people trying to get it.
Yeah. So you did like role play interview, like you where you would interview.
Yes, they were students and managers and stuff of the producers of the PBS.
But you had to act like you were interviewing a restaurateur or something, or a chef, or yeah.
But yeah, making stuff up is easy.
Yeah.
But that was very challenging. I'd done a lot of TV, but always in my control, meaning I would cook. So cooking, you know, I became very comfortable doing that on television. And presenting, and this was, I had to talk to people that had no experience on television, get them comfortable, and draw an interview out of them.
Yeah.
And so I had to really learn a new skill, and with a great coaching of the producers, Marjorie Punnett and everyone down there, you know, they really helped me a tremendous amount, because it is hard. It's, I have new respect for people that do interviews, like Jimmy Fallon or all the greats, you know, or even news people that do news interviews. It's not easy.
Yeah.
You know, you have to get a message. You have to get an answer. You have to get, especially if it's live. This is taped. But, you know, it's really, you have to draw a lot out for content to happen.
Yeah.
So it was a great experience. Very challenging. We taped 3 shows on Saturdays, back to back to back. So, you know, it was like,
yeah.
And, you know, it's sort of like, I don't mind doing physical activity. I like to hike and stuff, but, and being in a kitchen's challenging, but man, after you're exhausted after doing 3,
you're on
taping 3 shows,
time,
yeah.
You know?
I bet.
And then you do voiceovers and all this other stuff. So anyway, it was great. And Plate and Pour was something that Marjorie and I came up with and as an idea, and along with the team at Arizona PBS, they wanted to do their own content, and they were paying Chicago whatever for the PBS rights to use Plate. It was a Check Please thing. Was a Chicago thing.
Yeah, because so, there are multiple Check Pleases, right?
Most markets, San Francisco and stuff. So this was just, I wanted to go out in the field. I wanted to get stories from people. I wanted to celebrate Arizona through and the people and the culture of Arizona. I wanted to do it through the lens of food and spirits and beer and wine. I thought there was just so many stories to tell and uniquely Arizona, and I wanted to celebrate and bring a spotlight to Arizona. So that was the mission for the show. It still is today. And it really is my gift. My part is to give back to a business and community that's been so good to me. And I really, and also I don't, you know, when you're working in this business, I'm sure other chefs tell you, you just don't go out to eat that much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or when you do, you go to your corner bar and you kind of hide in the corner and you know, have some nachos. So I wanted to see, you know, I wanted to experience and I wanted to get out there. And there were people like, I remember one of the early shows was Matt Carter. And I'd known Matt for 20 years. You know, I knew him when he worked for Christopher down the street. And I've always admired him, always liked him, always got along. We'd be at shows or charities together, always got along. I didn't know him.
Yeah.
You know, we sat down and had an interview. It was really funny. The producers hated it. We talked for 2 hours.
That's and they were wonderful, like, though.
But you were in interview mode, right?
Yeah, like I was actually talking to him. It was
getting
interview,
to know
but
him.
Yeah. But we were having so much fun. I had so much fun talking to him in the interview that we just kept going and going and going. Because, again, you know people, but you don't know them.
Sure.
And what the gift for me is I would get in with, like, Tamara or Brett. We did film him, but that was just, he just left a few minutes after that. Yeah. So we couldn't do the show. We did a whole show on him. It was great. It was a great show, sadly. But anyway, I got to really just dig in, and it's only a half an hour show, so a lot of what is interviewed and a lot of what we get, you have to kind of distill it down to a package. But
sure.
But it's just been a great thing for me.
And it's so successful that Mark won an Emmy. Yes. As the host, and the show itself won.
We've been
last
nominated
year?
For 15, wow. And I've won 3. The show, I think, has won 7.
Dude, that's awesome. Like that. Congratulations. Yeah. That's incredible.
And I love that because it shows people are listening, too, and enjoying the stories.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you're a great host. Like, you're great. You bring a lightness to it, but you bring the knowledge as well.
Yeah.
And you're right, going to the place. Because that, like, Plate and Pour was, Check Please was great, but we always laughed at the B-roll of, like, the fork with, like, the cheese coming off of the macaroni.
Yeah.
They were great shots, but it was, you know, it was a little cheesy, you know?
Yeah.
But then Plate and Pour came, and it was like, holy shit, like, this is fantastic. Because we love all those travel eating shows, right? But when it's like, it's Preston, my buddy from Ren House, as he's winning the award. That was incredible.
That was a great day.
Yeah. And he hated it. He hated the, like, he already didn't like the camera in his face, being on camera. And then to get that, I bet you he was embarrassed. But
we had fun. And and that was one of the most fun shoots we did. Because, you know, I'm around food and wine a lot. But, you know, on the set, you know, I would generally drive myself to it. But Marjorie, the producer, said, well, you might want to, I love his beer, by the way.
Yeah.
And so she goes, you might want to take an Uber, you know, that way you can make it more casual, maybe take a sip. And I was like, okay. And I ended up like drinking like 3 beers. I mean, I was like, and Preston and I were like, yeah, this is great. This is fun. So, because the beer is so good, you know.
Yeah.
So I did, and that sort of happened a couple more times where they're like, drink more of this or drink this cocktail. So I started using Uber more.
Yeah.
But because, you know, there was a sensitivity with PBS, not me not drinking at one point. Like, on the set of Check Please, it was no drinking, it was just fake wine.
I always wondered that, because they were always full, very nice looking glasses. Right,
Welch's grape juice.
Yeah.
Yeah. One time I took a sip and I was like, what the heck did I just do? So, but they, you know, understood the premises. I'm not going to go all wasted. But
yeah. If so, you can cut that out. The beauty of editing,
it's
right?
It's authenticity.
Yeah. But it is, you know, it is fun to be able to just enjoy.
Yeah. Yeah. So you're, when you get this, the nominations for the Emmy, right? Mm-hmm. What is going through your guys' mind?
Well, I'm so, it's honestly just proud for the team. Because, you know, they've over the years been such great people, like Scott Olson and Alex Klein and Marjorie Punnett and Melissa, she's been great. And of course, you know, just there's just been so many people.
Sure.
Rebecca's are another producer. They're all just so good at what they do, that, you know, it is a team effort. And I know that it's, you know, I'm the face to it. You know, I'm the host, and I'm just one part of it. You know, editing is a big deal, and also capturing the images.
Sure.
And the sound is a huge deal. So, you know, I have an inside look of how difficult it is to put on a show and how much goes into it. And so getting those, it just felt so good as a team that we were able to accomplish something.
Yeah.
And so for me, it was a great validation, because you never know, like, when you're doing these things, especially we're only year one.
Yeah.
And we get like 8 nominations.
Yeah.
That was crazy.
Yeah.
And then this year we get 7, and then we won another 3 or something. And it was just great.
Yeah.
You know, but it's validation. And I was so glad, because only one is for me as a host, and all the other Emmys were for team.
For the team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so for me, I was so grateful. And they would always, after the Emmys, go, I'm so sorry I didn't get one. I was nominated. I was like, I don't care. I'll get the team got it. Are you kidding me?
Yeah.
We got it. We got it together. You know, like, woo.
Yeah.
Because the host thing is, you know, you know, that's, I mean, I'm glad I got one, but, you know.
You could tell them, too, like, well, I'm at least decent. Otherwise, you know,
it would have been.
So at least I'm holding you guys down, right?
Yeah, yeah. I know. I tell my, a lot of people just yawn. You know?
Yeah. All right, so what does the future of that show look like?
So it's on hiatus now, because the station's been closed since March. Hasn't been any production whatsoever since March. And even Horizon's being produced. You know, Ted is in his home, and it's very, very different. So we convinced Marjorie and I and Ebony Delaney, who's great, convinced them to go out in the field with just 2 people, a photog and, you know, a producer, and for us to go and do Plate and Pour takeout.
Okay. Yeah.
And the name was Ebony's idea. She's great. And so we're the only team doing anything.
Yeah.
Out in the field. So we're going to do 20 of these things that goes on IGTV. And our goal was that there are so many stories out there, but we need to continue to highlight the people who are out there doing stuff and they're open still and they need to be supported and, you know, to do takeout and to make it clever and fun.
And you've already posted how many of the takeouts?
Six I know or you seven did or maybe Ox, something like right? that. About seven.
Oh, gotcha.
Seven.
Okay, so these are already starting to...
They're on IGTV or Instagram. So
everybody tune in.
Yeah, to Arizona PBS or it's also on at Mark Tarbell, I think.
Okay.
We post them on there. So, yeah, so it really is to continue it in a way we can in COVID.
Yeah.
So I don't go in the restaurants. I take a bag. I sit on the gravel or in a parking lot. I eat takeout. I usually arrange it on a plate to make it fun.
Yeah.
And I leave. I mean, my verbal part of it, my script part is 1-2 lines, maybe.
Okay.
It's 45 seconds to a
so
minute.
So all kind of like bit more visual.
Yeah, it's visual. It's like pop, 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 pop. Great, you know, it's wonderful.
For attention span like me.
Yeah. Langston is our star photog on this one.
Okay.
And, he used to be a student at Cronkite and now is working at Cronkite.
Yes. Yeah, very nice.
He's amazing. So we're having a lot of fun, you know. So answer the question, we're looking for funding right now. I did a fundraiser with them on Zoom a couple nights ago. And, you know, we're just on that path of, because it takes a lot to produce Art in the 48, Plate and Pour. These are all original.
Yeah.
Arizona Catalyst and Horizon. They're all produced right here.
Yeah.
So they need money.
Gotcha. Yeah. And how can people find where to people?
I think they're probably there's probably a very easy way to donate on azpbs.org.
Okay.
Yeah. And if someone wants to write a big check, then, you know, I'll put them in touch with Marty.
Gotcha. Okay. Marty. We'll get them in touch with Marty. Yeah.
But we did have some very generous people a couple nights ago write some big checks.
So. Wow. Right. Nice.
So we're trying to raise $1.2 million for this local production season. That's everything that they do locally.
Yeah.
And, you know, that goes to all the shows. So we're all working together. Alberto Rios and myself and Ted Simons and the team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Excellent. Great. Good to know. Yes. So we got to hear about some of the celebrity people you've cooked for, right? Christina was...
people love to hear. Yeah.
I know. And it's one of those blank stares you're going to get from me because back in the day when there was celebrity and gossip columns, that they would always call me and I'd be like, I don't know.
They want to know, like, hey, what is this guy
who's
doing?
Been in, who's in last night? I heard someone was in last night. And I would literally forget. And then I have to go... Hey.
Well, because to him, they're friends.
Well, yeah, maybe, but also I was a little shy about it. You know, and a lot of the reasons the celebrities would come here in the past were because it got around that no one would be bothered. In fact, literally, no one would be bothered.
You could come here and just enjoy
like
your time.
Staff, it was cause for dismissal, and with customers, we just didn't allow it. We would protect them and block them. You know, so we've had so many over the years that have been awesome. And someone asked me because we're writing a book. I'm currently trying to write a book about this crazy place.
Oh, that's
yeah,
great.
It's been coming along.
I'll be first in line.
Well, yeah, thank you. But it's a project that's taking literally 20 years. It's taken about 10 now. But now I'm on it. I got a coach and I'm working. But so we made a list of what I could remember, you know, who I've served, cooked for, or met, or been here, and it's few pages.
Wow.
I don't have it with me, so I have no idea who's on.
You don't
it.
Have to go through the full list; just some highlights.
Well, who do you like? I mean, is there like music, or you like?
I'm a big
because
music
he's
fan.
Basically, cooked for everybody.
Wow.
Yeah. And what kind of music?
I love rock. I like all kinds of music.
Yeah.
Black Keys. Have the Black Keys been in here?
No.
Okay. All right.
Oh, good. I better jump in here. And interject. No, not that I know of. But you know,
guys, if you're listening, I know.
Yeah.
I hope you are.
No. I mean, from, gosh, I mean. Legends, you know, that we've cooked for, like Billy Joel backstage and B.B. King. And
who were some people, like memorable ones that were
Michael Douglas.
Michael
you've
Douglas
for.
Several times. Cheech Marin.
Yeah. You were very good friends with Muhammad Ali.
Muhammad Ali, very close.
Yeah. Julia and, Child.
Cooked at Muhammad's house a number of times. And Julia.
And
Jacques
you were
Pepin, very close
you
with
were
him.
Cooking for the Dalai Lama when Chef asked you
yes,
to
I was
be
in,
his client,
yes,
right?
Yeah. I can tell that story real quick. So so I was in New York in 1999. Chef Gordon, he invented the chef celebrity category.
Okay.
All his clients were like Emeril and, you know, he put him on Food Network.
Wolfgang
and blah, blah, blah,
Puck.
Wolfgang Puck. And so he invented it because he was a Hollywood and rock and roll and Hollywood agent. And he thought, these guys need an agent. And then he did it for a while, and he goes, there's no money. And there still is no money. No, I'm kidding.
I made a big mistake.
No. He still supports it, and it's been great. But so we were in New York in 1999, and we're staying at a hotel, and he asked me to come cook for the Dalai Lama, and I was with Emerald, John George, Danielle, Nobu, and so it was the Who's That with the Who's Who, and Michel Nishan. So literally the Who's That with the Who's Who. Yeah. That's me. It's my life. That's the name of my book. And I built up the courage to say, you know, I really want you to represent me because I want to be famous and have a TV show. At least that's what I thought. And there's a movie about him called Supermensch.
And it is an excellent movie.
What's
it's directed
called?
By, I think, Supermensch. Mike Myers.
Mike Myers,
right?
Yes.
Super what?
Supermensch.
Supermensch.
Which
Mensch
is a Jewish term for a good guy, great guy.
But it's
Yiddish
funny,
term.
It's clever, it's witty.
And he is a Supermensch.
It's a really great movie. I actually saw it at the special screening.
Right, yes.
And then Mark had the after party here.
Yep.
Ah.
Because he's in the movie.
I am.
Oh.
But I filmed like for days at Mike Myers' apartment. But it was one of those moments where I brought my absolute F game to TV. Because I know how you have to project on TV. Yeah. I've learned that over the years. And so what I did was like, yeah, how you doing? Hey, Mike. Ship's a creek. He's awesome. So guess what happened? Nothing. No, I spent 4 days of my life. Not a picture. No, I was toasting on the roof of his condo or whatever at the end. But but I ended up being around the whole shoot, which was fun, which is, again, Who's That with Who's Who. So I was there. And I said, Shep, would you represent me? And he took off his glasses and he looks at me in the eye and he goes, Mark, I will represent you, but I guarantee you will be an alcoholic, a drug addict. If you're married, you'll be divorced. And if I do my job well, and I will, you'll be dead. And I was like, can I think about that? He does it in the movie. I thought he just did it to me.
Yeah.
But apparently that's how he used to get his clients think about it.
So some people said, great, sign me up.
Yeah, and I've been around because I've known him so long and been close. So I said, next morning, I said, let's just be friends.
Yeah.
We've been friends ever since, which has been better. Because he's one of my dearest friends. And he really is, he's a very special person to me. But because of what he does, I've been around so many crazy people in so many crazy situations, but always as his friend and never as his client, which is different.
Sure.
And he's nice to his clients too, but it's a different thing.
Yeah.
And I've been.
So that's not a regret. That's
no,
not one of
that is. Well, for a while I thought I made a mistake because, you know, you always think I could be famous, and I really didn't want to be, and I still don't, you know, actually. But, you know, like one time he had a friend who started A&M Records and he has a big giant plane and he goes, it's been our dream to go truffle hunting. There's me, there's four of us. We're going on his plane to Italy to truffle hunt. I'm like, okay, I can do that. So, you know, beds, the whole thing.
Private, that might be a better perk.
Yeah. You know, so I'm like,
wow.
And it was cool.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of great things have happened. None of that's important other than our friendship. I mean, all those things are stuff, you know.
Sure.
This stuff.
Yeah.
That's my... Oh, then I cook for the Dalai Lama. Yeah, with all those guys.
Clint Eastwood, too. I think I saw Clint Eastwood
on the Clint's
list.
Yes, Clint's been here. So I had dinner with Clint down at Shep's house. And he's a lovely person and very engaging and just great.
Yeah.
And, you know, he looks at you and he's... wants to know about, you know, totally interested. Cool guy. There's celebrities that are celebrities and are very standoffish, and there are some that are so confident they don't need a detail. They don't need a pod. They don't need security. Yeah. He's one. You know, Charles Barkley, another. Muhammad Ali, you know, there's some.
Yeah.
And they have such charisma as people that it just doesn't happen.
Yeah.
No one bugs them.
Yeah.
Plus,
interesting.
You know, he's Clint. So,
people are
seen the movies.
Yeah.
No, but so he was nice and he goes, well, when I'm in Phoenix, I'll come see you. And of course, people say that.
Sure.
Right? So, 3 years later, 4 years later, you know, I come in. I don't know where I was, maybe next door. He's sitting over there where those guys are. And there was like, Clint Eastwood's in the restaurant. And I was like, wow, that is great. So, I don't bug people, but I'm the owner. So, I just wanted to. To say hey and just remind him, you know, Chef and I are friends. He goes, I know who you are, Mark. I told you I was going to come in. And I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, well, thank you.
Right.
And he goes, in fact, you should talk to the people at the Phoenician because I'm staying at that hotel and, you know, I was going out to dinner and they tried to tell me to go somewhere else. And I said, no, I'm going to Tarbell's. And I was like, yeah, right.
Thank you, Clint.
Oh, yeah. That's a what is it, endorsement if you've ever had one.
Yeah,
true fan.
Yeah.
I was like, they tried to pirate him. No, I'm kidding. But you know, to his credit as a man of integrity, which I believe he is, he just said he was going to do it and he did it. And he was very matter of fact about it when I met him.
Makes me like him even more.
Yeah, he's absolutely. Like, I know who you are, Mark. I told you I was coming to your restaurant.
Yeah.
It's 4 years later. I met him one time.
Yeah.
I'm like, all right, that's cool.
That story.
That is incredible, right? People that are masters in certain areas, I think, tend to have just, I don't know, maybe there's connections too, because I forget things very easily, but then there are things that I remember very well. You know? So I don't know what that all means, but.
Yeah.
Well, what's the future of Tarbell's? What's the future for Mark Tarbell?
Well, I hope we can open again tomorrow.
Sure.
That's what I'm hoping. to be honest, COVID has been a blessing in many ways. It's been very difficult, most difficult year of our life in so many. But one of the things is we've been able to go back to what we were.
Okay.
And I was a very, forward thinking. I never wanted to do things more than a few times. I didn't want a menu that was so established that I, could phone it in, and there was very limited ability to change, and that's what it had sort of become to a degree. Much to my, I was so grateful that it happened and that people loved things so much that's the way it was. But I was also, as a person and as my team, we were a little bit, it's hard. It's not hard. It's okay. And I taught people to honor it and love it and all that stuff. But right now we're just doing what we want, and no, we're still staying in the box. We're still staying in the Tarbell's window of Mediterranean Americana, and all farm to table and all that stuff. But we're doing, if we can do 5 dishes and they last five, they last night, then that's what we do. And they never come back.
Yeah.
A little bit of that. And then there's some stability in the menu, but, that's what we're doing. And we feel like we've been woken up again, and I'm so grateful. And, the food that we're doing for these guys is stunning. And we did a dinner for Carl McCoy a couple nights ago, and CCAP, a fundraiser, and we're back to it. And I think the engagement's been great. There's been some people that are, disappointed that certain favorites are gone, but for the most part, people are really, really joyous that, and they're coming in more.
Yeah.
And you just added this big patio right?
Just in time for the rain tonight.
Yeah, wow. It is raining. Yeah.
This is only the second night that it's been closed. But that's been a gift. When the executive order came out for us to be able to go out, literally, I'm like, in 2 days, I'm there.
And it's such an inviting patio.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah.
Well, we're happy. I mean, I want to keep this. I'm saying that out loud. I'm manifesting.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
This is temporary permit for COVID.
But Especially with our weather in Arizona, you should be able to take advantage of that.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So, what about the Travel Channel cooking show? Food
I've never had that great desire to be one of the, and I admire what they do, and it's not easy work, being a celebrity chef. You lose privacy to a degree, and you also travel a lot and stuff. But I still really feel passionate about this plate and pour thing, and the story of Arizona has not fully been told. And what I want to do is create something that will continue on beyond my either ability, interest, or they might can me.
Yeah.
That, another host will come, and, the plate and pour will continue to tell the story. Because I think that's important. So I am passionate about that. I do feel it's important, and I do feel it's really worth, spending some of my valuable time doing. And, whatever. I'll take it.
Yeah.
I'm playing around making a little wine now, so that's fun.
Oh, interesting.
Making a little wine? Yeah, you want to talk about that a little more?
A little while.
That's just a sneak peek.
Yeah, sneak peek.
Man. Well, Mark, it's been great. Christina talked you up beyond, and it's been an honor.
You're just a special person.
Well, thank you.
You can tell, his humility comes across, and he does so much for the community that you hear about and that you don't hear about, and I just admire that so much. Thank you,
Christina.
Mark.
We have something coming up too in one of our upcoming issues of A Taste of AZ magazine.
Oh yes,
right. Did you tell him about that?
Yes.
Okay.
He's giving me some people to contact. Yeah. I always forget the 6 degrees, seven degrees,
seven.
Yeah, anything
between 5 and 8
of Mark Tarbell, and it's a story about all the people's lives he's touched. Their favorite memories, chefs that have started at his restaurant,
Let me give you a different list.
too late.
I hope you find your own.
I have a few.
And please tell the people.
I'm definitely going to contact Bill now.
Yeah, please. And that would be interesting, actually. Please. And anyone that declines to participate, just
let them decline.
Only love. No problem.
Yeah.
Well, that's how I roll too. Yeah. Positivity, yeah. Especially in
totally respect,
times,
respect and love.
Yes. Well, I think it's incredible that not only are you you've been a leader in this industry out here for 30 plus years, and to meet you and you be such a great dude, and just like a normal guy. And that's because I told Christine, I'm like, I'm nervous. Like I've done probably close to 300 podcasts total, and I get a little bit nervous for each one. This one was special though.
Oh,
so,
thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
But Christine was like, he's a great guy, and you've lived up to that.
Thank you.
So thank you so much for taking the time to do this.
Thank you. Great interview. I loved it. Thank you, Christina.
Great. I love
you're awesome.
Learning even more about
I was
you.
On your first day. Yay.
Yeah. Well, first part.
With you.
Yeah.
I've done a couple with
Luke.
Okay,
good.
But with this new company, I don't want to say company.
Yeah, that's we're going to collaborate.
Oh, good.
Yes.
I think that's wonderful.
I now know to look for burgundies. I like burgundies.
Yes,
you
will.
Yes.
If that's what you like, you'll like it. And if you can find with a little age, that's what happens.
Okay.
Good Excellent. Ones with a little age, yes.
Start saving up.
or if you don't have it with age, just put it in a blender. That'll help. And then pour it in a glass.
Wait, really?
It Why? Aerates.
Well, oxygen is what degrades or ages wine.
Okay.
Contact oxygen. And through a cork, it's very slow.
Yeah.
And measured. And if you put it in a blender, it's pretty quick.
I like
but
that.
No, I didn't actually
From
say
Mark
that.
Tarbell,
out loud.
We're
going to use that as the lead.
No, I'm going to get so criticized for that.
Well, in place of a
in
blender,
theory.
You can use an aerator. Right?
Yeah, there you go. There you go. Go buy a very expensive
There's
aerator.
There's a brand of aerator called Blender. That's what he was talking about.
Yes, right? Or just go to Target and get a blender. Okay.
Mark, thank you so much. We appreciate this.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Awesome. Thanks for having me on, and thanks for taking time out of your busy schedule.
It's awesome. My pleasure.
Thanks, guys.
Well, guys, there you have it, Mark Tarbell. Make sure you follow him and his restaurant on social media, as well as A Taste of AZ. See you next time.